Hello everyone. The topic for the day is introduction to database systems. As we have already discussed in the previous sections that what was file-oriented approach, there were some drawbacks in the file-oriented approach like lack of security and due to which database approach has been implemented. Next please. Now the contents which we are going to discuss are database definition, components of database, characteristics of database, advantages of database and disadvantages. Now first we have to think that what is database. The definition says that database is a collection of facts and figures that are interrelated to one another and which represents some meaningful information. Now this definition has been split into three parts basically. First is facts and figures. Now what are the facts and figures? Facts and figures are any real world life things. Any real world life things which exist in this real world life. Like a person. Person exists in this real world life. Table exists in this real world life, but we have to bifurcate between these all real world life things. We can have two types of things. One is which are having some physical existence and one is which are having some conceptual existence. Physical existence entities of real world life things are those which can be seen, touched and felt. And conceptual existence entities are those which cannot be seen, touched and felt. Like non-living things, like table, and living things like person, human beings, all come under physical existence entities, and job, company, they all come under conceptual existence entities. Further, all the things which we have in this real world life, or we have to store the data about these things. Interrelated. Interrelated means that these are having some relationship among each other. Like we are storing information about the student. Student is what we have to store. We store the information about the student, right? Roll number, name, class, address, phone, and email ID. Then in this case, how the information is interrelated? That all we are storing the information of all the students which belong to one class, like MC or PC. Meaningful information. Now, whatever information we are storing, that should reveal some implicit meaning. The word here is implicit. Implicit meaning. Implicit may also be termed as inherent or inherent meaning. Inherent meaning means whenever we have a look at that information, it should have a self-explanatory meaning. It should reveal a meaning on its own that what the information is trying to say. Like we were talking about the student database. Whenever anyone sees the information about the student, then it is easily resembling that the information is about the students of a particular class or students of a particular stream or students of a particular college. We don't need help of any other person who has to guide us that for which information we are resembling. So we can say here that database is a collection of such facts and figures which are existing in this real world life and which are interrelated to one another and which represent some meaningful information. Now, the biggest point here is that how do we identify between data and information? Data and information. Raw facts and figures are known as data and it is in unorganized format. Further, the data is further processed. Which becomes meaningful information is information always conveys some meaning, but the data may or may not convey a meaning. Now, components of database. Basically, the database approach is divided into four primary components. One is data, one is hardware, one is software, and one is users. Now, the biggest benefit of database approach is that the database contains not only the database itself, but also complete definition and description of data. Now this definition and description of data is stored in system catalog. Or system catalog may also be termed as data dictionary. This link was not present in file-oriented approach. This has been introduced in database approach. Now, whatever description of data we are going to store, first of all we need to give a definition of data and then we have to store it into the system catalog. After that only we can store the data part. Now the information which is stored in data dictionary system catalog. that information is known as metadata. Metadata or database schema. Database schema. Now this description of database, like we are saying system catalog or data dictionary, it is specified during the database design process. Whenever the database is being really prepared, first design process, and it is used by database users or the database administrator, but not by the normal users. And it is not expected to change frequently, whereas the actual data of the database may change frequently. Now the second is hardware. Hardware consists of two primary parts. Secondary storage devices and primary storage. Secondary storage devices, all the associated hard disks, like earlier we were having tapes, drives, and disks, drums, which were used to hold the large mass of data. And here we are talking about big hard disks. As recently we are having a very huge capacity of hard disks in terabytes and megabytes also. So secondary storage devices, which are used to hold the large mass of data, huge data, these are being stored in the, these are to be considered in the case of hardware part. We need to decide that what is the preliminary requirement for the capacity which is required for the database. Second is primary storage. Primary storage, we are having RAM. Random access memory. Random access memory, which is used to store the hold the execution of data. As the RAM will be higher in megabytes or gigabytes, then the processing capacity of database will be larger and it will be higher. Similarly, one more point comes here is processor. High speed processor will help in efficient and faster retrieval of data from the database. Third is software. Now, as we know that we cannot interact with the hardware part of the computer directly, we need some medium like operating system. Similarly, we can also not interact with the database part directly, and we need some medium in between. Between the user and the physical database itself, there is a layer of software which is known as DBMS. DBMS. DBMS is Database Management System. All the requests from the users to access the data from the database goes and passes from the DBMS, and the DBMS processes them on the database and in turn receives the responses from the database and gives it to the intended user. Now what can be the request? What can be the request which we are talking about? The request which the user can ask. The user can ask anything for data insertion, insert, update, delete, and retrieve. Retrieve means that user has to view it. Insertion, if you want to add some data in the database. Updation, if you want to update the existing database. Data present in the database. Deletion, if we want to delete the existing data present in the database. Retrieve, if you only want to view the data present in the database. Now, next is users. Users are the people who are accessing the data of the database. Now, users are broadly divided into three categories: application programmers, database administrator, and end users. Who are the application programmers now? Who are the application programmers? Application programmers are those people who write the application programs which are using the database, through which we can access the data of the database. Like previously we were writing the programs in nowadays language, and if we have to use the application programs, through programming we are having PLS. Right? Next is database administrator. Database administrator is a person or a group of persons who are having centralized control of database. Now, centralized control of database means all the authority lies in the database administrator. If we have to grant access or authorization for accessing some data on the database, then it has to be decided by the database administrator. If user A and B we are having, user A is the owner of one particular table and user B has to access it, then user B has to seek the permission from user A. Next, coordinating and monitoring the use of the data present in the database and also acquiring the hardware and software resources whenever necessary. Now, what is this point, acquiring hardware and software resources whenever necessary, is that as the database is created, the size of the database is not very huge. But whenever the data is populated in the database, side by side, the size of the database becomes very enormous, huge. And we need to decide that whether we have to install some additional hardware part or not at the site, like the hard disk should be increased, RAM should be increased, or processor capacity and speed should be increased. These all the decisions have to be taken by the database administrator. Lastly, here we are having end users. End users are divided into these parts. Sophisticated end users, parametric end users, standalone users. Parametric may also be known as mail for parametric end users. Now, standalone users are we people who are accessing the database for our own personal medium or mechanism, like if we have to store the data about our investments in taxes for tax purposes, their database, all the standalone users are accessing. Neighbor parametric end users, all those people who are accessing the data for some time and they are using updates or inserts. Now, sophisticated end users, those people who are like engineers, scientists, who need to access the data and meet their own business requirements. Next, please. One was casual end users. Fourth category was casual end users. Casual end users are those who need to access the data occasionally, but every time they need some different information. Now, this is the system how the database works. Is users and programmers people. Users and programmers give their request in the form of application programs or queries, as we already discussed, and these application programs are passed on to the DBMS, DBMS collects the application programs and queries from the user and it processes them on the database. Now, this whole is the database. As we already discussed, the database is divided into two parts. One is data part and data definition part. We have already discussed previously here. Data definition and data part. The similar thing is being shown here. Now, after the requests have been processed, now the result is to be passed. The results are similarly passed on back to the intended user. Next, please. Next, we are having characteristics of database approach. We are having basically six primary characteristics of database: existence of system catalog or data dictionary. Now, database contains not only the database itself but also complete definition and description of database. This definition and description is stored in system catalog or data dictionary. Now, the information which is stored in data dictionary is known as metadata or database schema, which is not required to change frequently, but actual data may change frequently. Now, the biggest point here is that if we are changing the data dictionary part or system catalog part, it may have a change or effect on the data part of the database. But if you are changing the data part, it may not have an implication or change of the data dictionary part. Now, data present in the database is both integrated and shared. By integrated, we mean By integrated we mean that database is not one file, it is a collection or unification of many data files which are being stored with minimum redundancy. Minimum redundancy. Redundancy here is duplicacy. Shared we mean that at the same time many users can access the data of the database. In file-oriented approach, it was not possible for unlimited number of users to access the same file simultaneously at the same time. But in database approach, there is no limit on the number of users who are accessing the data of the database. Unlimited number of users can access the data of the database. This is the biggest benefit of database, which we will be covering in advantages also, which is our next topic here. And the thing is, next is programmed data independence. Now, in the case of programmed data independence, the structure of data files is embedded in structure of data files. Structure of data files is embedded in application programs. When we are talking about file-oriented approach, in case of file-oriented approach, the structure of data files is embedded in application programs. So whenever we need to change the structure of data files, we need to change the application program that accesses that file. But this thing has been eliminated from database approach, and that's why we say that programmed data independence is the characteristic of database. Here, the structure of data files is specified in system catalog. And application programs are written separately. Separately of any data files. So if we need to change here, we are not required to change the application programs. If we are required to change the application programs, we are not required to change the structure of data files, that is system catalog. So this provides programmed data independence to the database system. Next is programmed operation independence. As we have already said that we were having real world life things which are being stored, and if we are talking about object-oriented programming or object-oriented programming, everything is considered as an object. Now when everything is considered as an object, then in this case we can say that database approach also plays an important role in object-oriented databases. Object-oriented databases. Now in case of object-oriented databases, we are having operations, data. Now operation is specified in two parts, interface or signature part, method or implementation part. Interface or signature part, like we are having a function name, interface name, and data type of its arguments or parameters. Method of implement or implementation, actual implementation of the operation. Now, how the users can access their data through object-oriented databases? Users can invoke the operations by interface part and operation name and data type of its arguments and parameters, and they can retrieve the data very easily. Next is data abstraction. Now the characteristic which provides both program data independence and program operation independence, if we merge and combine program data independence and program operation independence, then we see that data abstraction is achieved. Abstraction is basically hiding the storage level details which are not of the interest of the basic user and only providing the information which is only relevant to the intended user. Now, in programmed data independence, we were providing information about descriptions of data, but here in programmed operation independence, in addition to providing the description of data, we are also providing operations of data. What operations are being performed on data part? Multiple views of data. Next point. views of data, when we are talking about multiple views of data, as we have already said, that database is being capable of being accessed by many users. Unlimited number of users can access the data of the database. So every user may require some different view of data. Means some may want to access limited information, some may want to access unlimited information, and we may also restrict some information from the user A, and we may restrict some information from user B. So every user may require a separate view of data. Now, view is nothing but it is a subset of data which is derived from the database and explicitly stored. Now, the users are unaware of the fact that whether the data present in the database is stored or derived. We are having two types of data, stored or derived. Stored which already exists and derived which has been derived from the existing data. Sharing of data on multiple transactions. Now, the biggest characteristic here of database terms is sharing of data on multiple transactions. The data of the database is both integrated and shared. By integrated, we mean that the database is a collection and unification of many data files which are being stored without the minimum redundancy. And by shared, we mean that at the same time, many users, which nevertheless they are located at any location, geographical location, they can access the data without any complexity and without waiting for what they are accessing. Now, this is most important in banking transactions and airline reservation systems. Next slide, please. Now, here we are having some advantages of database. Basically, the advantages of database have been divided into seven broad advantages: reduction of redundancies, security, enforcing standards, providing backup and recovery, availability of up-to-date information, enforcing integrity constraints, and flexibility. Now, reduction of redundancies. What is redundancy? Redundancy is duplicacy, as we have already discussed here. Now, we are having basically two types of database. One is centralized. And one is distributed database. In case of centralized database, the whole data of the database is stored at one central place, one single point, or one single computer in at one location. And all the users can access the data from that place, that from that particular computer. But in distributed database, the database is divided into various local sites. One site may be present at A location and another site may be present at B location. So the database is distributed at many places and the user can access it as it is easily approachable to them. Now, centralized control of database effectively reduces the storage space. Extra processing The centralized control of database effectively reduces the storage space which is required to store the data, because one data will be stored only at only one place, then there will be reduction in space and redundancy, elimination of redundancy, you can say, elimination of redundancy. Also, extra processing which is required for tracing the data in a large mass of data, that is also reduced. Because we have to trace one information only once, if it is being stored at once. Next is security. As we have already said that, security, in case of security, multiple users are accessing the database. Multiple users. When multiple users are accessing the data of the database, then all users may not be authorized to access all the data, means whole information. Some users may have only access to read data, Some may be having access to write header or update. Some users may have only access to retrieve the data or view the data. So it is very important that only authorized users access the data of the database, and unauthorized users are not able to access the database. We are having basically two types of users: unauthorized users and authorized users. Unauthorized users are those users who are not having access, who are not having authority, privilege, right, to access a particular type of data for which they are referring to. And authorized users are those users who are having access or who are having authority or privilege to access one particular kind of data what they are referring to. Now, we must ensure that only authorized users access the data of the database. For this, we are providing a security mechanism. Every user has a user ID and password, like we created email IDs. In case of email IDs, every user has a user ID, email ID, password. Similarly, whenever the user has to access the database, the user is given a user ID and password through which the user can access the data and perform various operations for which the user is authorized to do. Now, we can also broad this topic on the basis of multiple security levels. Multiple security levels will also be implemented here. Multi-level security, this is a concept where we categorize our data and users into top secret, secret, confidential and unclassified. Top secret, secret, confidential and unclassified. The people who are present at the top secret level, they can view only their information, plus secret level, plus confidential, plus unclassified. The people who are present at, or the data which is present at the secret level, they can view their own information, plus confidential, plus unclassified. The top secret level information is hidden from them. The people who are present at confidential level, or the data which is present at confidential level, it is viewable only by the confidential level users and the unclassified users. The secret level and top secret level is hidden from the confidential level users. Similarly, if we talk about unclassified data and users, they are able to view the data which is presented at the unclassified level, but they are not able to view confidential, secret and top secret level. Next is enforcing standards. The database system provides facilities for enforcing standards among their database. Now, standards can, why we require standards here? We require standards here for display formats of data present in the database, report structures, how the data will be displayed, that is very important, that should be specified in advance, and what are the reporting mechanisms, what are the reporting structures, how the reports will be generated from the data which is present in the database, if you want it in a printable format or whatever it is. Now, the user is only interested with the data. The user is not interested with whether the data is stored or derived. The user only requires the data, whether it is stored or derived. Like, if we are having name and age of a person entity, then name is given, date of birth is given. Now, how will we calculate the age of a person? We can calculate the age of a person through current year and year of birth or date of birth. Now, age is derived from name and date of birth. And name and date of birth is a stored data, age is a derived data. All these things are being observed in the representation of data. Next is providing backup and recovery. The database approach provides facilities for recovering and from hardware and software failures. Basically, we are having two types of failures. One is hardware failure and one is software failure. In case of hardware failure, In case of hardware failure, some of the hardware components may crash, like hard disk will crash, and the main memory failure, like RAM. And in case of software failure, the operating system may become corrupt. Or we can also say that the database which we are using that falls below the line and it is being corrupted by the virus and all. Now, what we are trying to say here is the database approach provides facilities for recovering from hardware and software failures. How it provides recovery from hardware software failures? So it's backup and recovery subsystem. Backup and recovery subsystem of database is responsible for restoring the database to the state where it was before the failure. Now suppose if the database fails within a complex problem, then the database is responsible for restoring the data to the point when it was before the failure, restoring the state before the failure. Now availability of up-to-date information. This is the biggest advantage of database, that whenever the user is accessing the data of the database, like we are having user A, user B, user C, user D, user E, all are accessing the database from multiple locations. Some may be located in India, some may be located in US. All the users are accessing the database, which is centrally located at one center point. Now, if user A is updating some information in the database, similarly, user B is also updating some information in the database, and user E has to view the data of the database. Now, as soon as the user A has updated the information, user E can immediately see the update. As soon as user D has updated the information, user C can immediately see the data. Similarly, D, similarly, A. Now, this is very important case of transaction processing systems like banking systems. If we are making withdrawals or deposits, then the terminal manager can easily view the balances, upgrades and all. And also in case of airline reservation systems, where if we are booking a seat on the airline, then the number of vacant seats are reduced and number of filled seats are increased. Next is enforcing integrity constraints. Now, database approach also provides facilities for enforcing integrity constraints among the database. Now, what is a constraint? Constraint is basically restrictions or barriers which are being imposed on the insertion, deletion, or updation of data of the database. Now, the simplest type of constraint is specifying the data type of a data item. Data type of data item. Data type of data item. Like if we say that name should be character and it should be 30 characters long. Now this is a constraint which we have, restriction which we have imposed, that the name should, the value of name can only mean character and it cannot exceed 30 characters. Its length should be 30 characters. This is the simplest other constraint. We may have some other complex types of constraints also, like uniqueness constraints. Uniqueness constraints says that the value corresponding to a particular attribute or value corresponding to a particular field should be unique and it should not be repeated. It should not be duplicated. Last is flexibility. Now, as the users increases, as the data of the database increases, we may also require changes in the files, data files. We may also require a physical reorganization of data files. Now, the database provides flexibility by adding new contents in an existing file or updating an existing file or deleting the contents of an existing file without having any effect on the remaining part of the database. Next please. Now we are going to discuss about disadvantages. Everything which is being invented in this real world life has pros and cons both. Pros we have already discussed. A about the database. Now we are going to discuss about the disadvantages or cons of the database. Basically, there are three disadvantages of database. Cost of hardware, software and migration. Now the cost of purchasing the hardware, as we have discussed in the components of database, that we require hardware devices and we require the private storage devices also like RAM and processors only. Initially, the cost may not incur very much, but as the size of the database increases or expands, the cost of hardware increases. If we want to migrate from a gigabyte hard disk to a terabyte hard disk, then the cost issue may involve here. If we want to go from a processor like Core i3 to Core i7 or i5, then the cost may involve here. And similarly, RAM. If we want to migrate from 2GB RAM to 4GB or 8GB RAM, then the cost may arise here. And the cost may not be affordable for each and every one. And now, cost of software. Cost of software here is that cost of purchasing the software, like Oracle database, these all are paid softwares. The cost of purchasing these softwares is in dollars and it is not easily affordable by everyone. And migration, if we are migrating, if we are shifting from a traditional environment to an integrated one, here we come the case of migration. This case comes when one version of the software is being transformed to a newer version or upgraded version. Want to have maximum features or benefits. Now, second is complexity of backup and recovery. As we have already discussed, that the database can also be stored at one central location, which is a centralized database. Now, it means that we need to keep a backup. Backup means we need to keep a copy of that database at some another place, so that in case of failure, we can recover the database from the backup copy of the database, and we can process for the routine operations. But the backup and recovery procedures, algorithms are fairly very complex, and it are not easily being possible for the ordinary person. We require a lot of study in that. Last is problem is associated with centralization. Now, centralization is the biggest advantage because it reduces redundancy, but at the same time, it also comes under the part of disadvantages because failure of one component of computer system may fail the entire system. And the database will be stored at one central location, and if the database will be stored at one central location, then if that computer fails, then the entire system will fail and you will not be able to access the data of the database. So these were some basic concepts which we discussed today, definition, components, introduction to the database, components, advantages and disadvantages of database. In the next lecture, we will be going further and we will be studying about three schema architecture and the data independence and further data models. Thank you very much. That's